In this video, we'll continue with the outstanding features of the Indian Constitution. So, the first point we'll make in this video is accounting for the states and their uniqueness. The Constitution of the United States deals only with the federal government and leaves the states to draw up their own constitution. The Indian Constitution, however, is a single constitution providing for both the union and the states. This is a very important point, please note it. So in the US, there is a federal government that takes care of all federal laws and the states have to draw up their own constitution. In India, there is only a single constitution for both the union and the states. Since the states have differences, historical, cultural, lingual, and political, special provisions had to be made for different states. If you just look at Article 372, which has now been scrapped, and if you look at Article 371 through to the alphabets, you will see that over 12 states have special provisions in the constitution because of the nature of the population of the states. So the first point that we look at is the special provision for Jammu and Kashmir. Only the state of Jammu and Kashmir was allowed to make its own constitution thanks to the weakness and short-sightedness of Jawaharlal Nehru and his tendency to play to the galleries. This would go on to prove quite a disaster in the decades to follow. Jammu and Kashmir was given a special status and a great majority of the provisions of the Indian Constitution would not apply to Jammu and Kashmir. Article 1 and Article 370 of the Indian Constitution apply to Jammu and Kashmir. This will be discussed in great detail at a later point in course, but please remember that Article 370 was scrapped in August of 2019. As of now, there is only one constitution in India and it applies to the entire territory, although there are certain special provisions for specific Indian states. We also have Nagaland, Sikkim, Karnataka and other states running from Article 371 to Article 371J, which have been inserted to tackle the regional problems and the demands of certain states. Please run through these articles once. It can be found in the constitution that is there in the Rama IAS app. We'll now look at the federal relations. The features that best describe the federal provisions are two governments, one at the state and one at the center. Division of powers between the union and the state, written constitution, supremacy of the constitution, rigidity of the constitution, independent judiciary and bicameralism. The Indian constitution contains all of these features. I repeat, the features that best describe the federal provisions are two governments, one at the state and one at the center, division of powers between the union and the states, written constitution, supremacy of the constitution, rigidity of the constitution, independent judiciary and bicameralism. Bicameralism means that there are two houses. For example, you have Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. This is bicameralism. The Indian constitution consists of all of these features. In addition, it also consists of some unitary features. For example, a strong center, single constitution, single citizenship, flexibility of constitution, integrated judiciary, appointment of state governor by the center, all India services, emergency provisions, etc. All of these are features of a unitary government. Although India is a federal government, it has strong unitary features. So India is called a federal government with unitary features. The Indian Constitution is described as a union of states. It has nowhere been called a federation. Remember that the United States is a federation. That is, the states came together to form a single country. But in India, we do not say that. We say that we are a union of all states and the states have no right to secede from the Indian Union. The political history of India and the lessons learned thereof induced the framers of the Indian Constitution to give it a unitary bias. It also led them to make detailed provisions regarding the distributions of powers and functions between the Union and the states and all aspects of their administrative and other activities. if you just see the videos in Indian National Movement and India after independence, you will see that, you know, Sardar Patel and VP Menon had to work really hard to stitch together the Indian nation, because there were so many princely states and there were so many states. All of these had to come together. To control all this, India needed a unitary feature within the framework of federation or federalism. This is what the constitution makers gave the country. So provisions have been made for interstate relations, coordination and adjudication of disputes among other states, etc., within the constitution itself. These are important constitutional provisions. As we go ahead in the course, we will read about all of these. That is interstate relations, coordination and adjudication of disputes among other states, issues between the union and the states, etc. All of these have been addressed within the constitutional framework. These provisions have been included in Part 11 of the Indian Constitution under two heads, that is legislative relations and administrative relations. Articles 245 to Articles 263 deal with the relations between the union and the states. Please remember this. This is important. So the next one we'll look at is the inclusion of justiciable and non-justiciable rights, that is the fundamental rights, the directive principles of state policies and fundamental duties within the Indian Constitution. The fundamental rights guarantee justiciable rights to the individual following the Western precedents. In addition, there is also the directive principles of state policy, the concept borrowed from the Irish constitution, which is non-justiciable in nature. So fundamental rights are justiciable, directive principles states directive principles of state policy are non-justiciable. So the directive principles have been borrowed from the Irish constitution. However, the directive principles are regarded to be fundamental to the governance of the country. They show the vision towards which the nation must head. The directive principles of state policy have both social and Gandhian principles in addition to the liberal points of view. So there are three parts to the directive principles. That is, it has liberal principles, it has social principles, and it has Gandhian principles. When we study about directive principles of state policy, we will look at this in greater detail. The directive principles of state policy are to serve as moral restraints and guidelines upon future governments and to preserve the spirit in which the constitution was written. This is the function and purpose of the directive principles of state policy. That is, to serve as a moral restraint and to guide future governments towards the vision towards which the Indian nation must head. Owing to problems that were unique and peculiar to India, like untouchability, preventive detention, etc., the fundamental rights in India are more comprehensive in letter than elsewhere in the world. The fundamental duties was added to the Indian Constitution by the 42nd Amendment Act of 1976. They have no legal sanction. However, every citizen is expected to follow the list of fundamental duties. If you go to Part 4A of the Indian Constitution, you will find the fundamental duties. Please read through them. It is necessary for the prelims. This concludes this video. We will continue with the outstanding features of the Indian Constitution in the next video as well. Thank you.